That's his name.
You know his last name?
Jimmy Walsh.
Okay.
Jimmy Walsh, who almost went pro. He was a very successful amateur, but because of an injury, he didn't go pro, but he was fantastic. He was on the USA team, and he was great. And I hired Jimmy to teach me how to jump rope, and he said, you look like you could hit something. He taught me how to jump rope in 15 minutes. That was it. Before I knew it, I had wraps and gloves on, 16 ounce. He was showing me the jab and the cross, and all of a sudden, I got into it. And he started setting me up matches and just, you know, low-key sparring. But I was pretty good. And the rest, as they say.
The rest, as they say, is history.
Yeah.
So with that said, you know, it's no, I'm going to do something I've never done before, ladies and gentlemen. I've never... Like, I've shadow boxed a little bit in the studio, just a little bit, having fun when the music is going on, getting into it. But we're going to actually do some boxing in the studio. How cool is that? So hold on a second, ladies and gentlemen.
Not cool for me, I don't think.
Yeah, it's very cool for you. I am. See, and this is not being braggadocious. This is not being arrogant. I'm just good as a teacher in boxing. I mean, I can do it in my sleep. So we're going to have some fun.
Sounds good. I could use all the help I can get.
Okay. Make sure you listen up now. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, here we go. We're gonna get into a little boxing here in the studio. Boxing in the studio. All right, let me see. What's up here? Let me see that jab, Chad. Let me see that jab. Oh, you got a good jab there, ladies and gentlemen. All right, let me see that right hand. All right, pretty good, pretty good. Two, one, two. Good. One, two. Good. Let me step back. One, two, one, two. You like to be close. Yep. Bang. Set that foot. There you go. Set right hook. One, two. Ha ha. One, two. Is my music going?
Need a little rocky.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let me get my music going again. Start this over. There we go. A little bit more rocky. All right, here we go. Left jab. One, two. One, two. One, two, one, two. Left one. First time doing boxing, actually boxing in the studio. That was fun. So Michael, tell me how you incorporated boxing and networking. Knockout networking.
I know. Well, you know, it kind of evolved. You know, my brand was different. I had a different company name. It was called Building Blocks Consulting. And that's how it started 15 years ago. And then I got involved with the whole boxing and the jump rope and the sparring and the everything else and amateur stuff.
Were you already speaking already?
I was already speaking. I was already talking about networking and referrals. But it was really under the banner, under the brand of Building Blocks Consulting. And then I started telling boxing stories in my talks. And it wasn't planned, but I always had a story. And I kept saying boxing like
people
networking.
People love stories.
Oh, yeah, people love stories. But the metaphor became boxing like networking is about the connection. So I was teaching people how to make more and better connections. So more and better connections make you successful in the ring, of course, right? But also in business, the more and better connections you make, the more successful you're going to be. So just over time, it just kind of morphed. And I remember speaking to a very large group. It was an insurance company in Dallas, Texas. I remember telling a boxing story, and some big cowboy stood up and said, "You're a real knockout networker."
A cowboy?
Yeah, big guy in Dallas. So I just laughed, and I said, he like just gave me a gift right there. And the whole thing just evolved from there. Though I was already writing the book, but now I had the name for the book. And everything just sort of morphed into that.
He said, "You're a knockout networker."
Knockout networker. And I said, "Oh, my gosh, yes, I am."
Wow.
And Building Blocks Consulting was no more.
You know, let me just say this. Thousands and thousands of speakers out there. This truly makes you stand out. You know, it's funny. I have a picture of me like years ago, like back in the... I would say back in the 90s, where I took a picture and I had a suit on. I didn't bring an old business card, and I got the boxing gloves on. And so here you are. You did it, man.
Well, you know, it really kind of puts me in a different category because people really identify with the boxing thing. And, you know, being in New York, of course, but everybody's got a boxing story.
Right.
Or everybody's relative knows a former pro. Or, I mean, it just, people can relate, even women. You know, I mean, I kind of toned down the boxing thing, but, you know, it doesn't matter. I mean, even women, you know, have a story. And now with Ronda Rousey and the whole thing, I mean, it kind of doesn't matter. You know, it's a fight at the end of the day. And I'm working with salespeople, and every day is a grind, and every day is a fight. So you got metaphors all over the place. And
every day is a grind. Every day is a fight.
Yeah, that's right. Especially when you're beating the streets and you're looking to, you know, get business and make sales. And all I do is work with salespeople, so they get it too.
You know what they used to call my boxing teacher? Mr. Poetry in Motion. That was my wow, is that cool?
That is cool.
That was
cool.
My teacher, Mr. Poetry in Motion. And let me tell you quickly about his, speaking of stories.
Yeah.
He was a fighter. He beat 3 world champions. And so he was fighting this guy. A Latin guy, good fighter, he would say. He said he was a good fighter. And he did something to him in the ring. He did some kind of move on him. And he thought they was going to count to 10, and that was it. But the guy died in the ring. Bobby, his name is Bobby McQuilla. He retired on the spot. And he said the reason why he retired, because what he did, it was an accident. And he said that if he got in a jam and did that again, then he felt it would be murder. Mm-hmm. So he retired on the spot. And never fought again. He said he started teaching boxing. He said, "But I never taught what I did in the ring."
Right.
And knowing me, the nice guy I am, I never asked him, "What did you do?" I never asked him, "What did you do in the ring?"
Yeah, I'd be curious. I'd be curious what shot it was, what type of punch.
I don't think he would. I wouldn't ask him because Bobby was just a guy of character.
Yeah.
Class. I just wouldn't ask him.
Well, you know, it's a dangerous game. You know, it's glamorous on TV. You know, you watch the Mayweather and the Pacquiao, and you watch all these guys on TV all the time. And boxing becoming more mainstream now. With it, you know, I mean, there's a fight almost every Saturday, and now it's on, you know, the regular stations on NBC and CBS.
That's how I grew up.
Yeah, I mean, it's so now it's on almost Saturday night, and it's glamorous. There's people in suits in the front row, but you know, it's dangerous getting in that ring. It takes a lot of guts climbing through those ropes, and you know, getting to know more pros and guys like you, and you know, respect. You know, it's to me, I'm just an amateur, just yucking it up. You know, but the guys that do this for a living, I mean, this is a hard thing, and you don't know if you're coming out of that ring.
That's right. Let me identify ourselves.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rick Young, another segment of What's in Your Hand here at WHCR, here on the campus of City College, where people are getting bachelor's degrees, master's degrees, and PhDs. And today you're going to get a boxing degree, a knockout degree, a networking degree. They should have a degree in networking. There should be a course on networking, like a course, because people need to... Here's in your book, Michael, it says, it is my belief that other than possibly curing a disease, you can accomplish almost anything through networking. I even think that you could even cure a disease. Not you physically, but you could put two people together, the two right doctors or scientists together that didn't know each other because of you and your networking skills, connecting skills. Which is connecting a part of networking?
Sure, sure.
Explain.
Well, I mean, nothing great happens without that connection. You know, if two people meet and they don't like each other, nothing good's going to come out of that. You know, so there has to be a connection. There has to be this vibe. And you always know when you connect with somebody. You know, it's just easy to talk to them. You've got stories that you're able to exchange, and you're completely engaged in the conversation.
Do you and I have a connection?
I think we got a connection, yeah. So that left hook was a good connection. But yeah, I think so. I think we definitely have a connection. Yeah. But when it's just easy to talk to somebody, you want to talk to them. You want to... You know, catch a beer with them. It's not a strain spending time with them, whether it's face to face or on the phone or whatever it is. That's a connection, you know, and it doesn't happen all the time.
So here's the problem, Michael. And there's the problem. The problem is that everybody networks, but many, many people do not know how to do it properly. They don't know how to do it properly.
Yeah.
They think, oh, I ask people, are you a good networker? Oh, well, I do it sometimes. When it comes to my business, yeah, I do it. And when they say that, I know that they don't really understand what networking is. Because tell me if I'm wrong. Or tell me I want you to respond to this comment.
Yeah.
Networking is a way of life.
Well, networking is a lifestyle. It's you know, and the way I describe it when I speak about it is, and I talk about that there's really only five reasons why people network. It's to write more business, to do more business, to land a job, social reasons, you know, to make friends or date or that type of thing. And you got all the dating sites out there, you know, to kind of help with that, to learn something, and then to solve a very specific problem. Right. So you have to have a process in order to accomplish one or a combination of those five things. And networking is not a switch that you flip on or shut down when you think you need to land a job or you're looking to write business or social. Like, my switch is always on. My peripherals are always wide. I am always thinking like a connector, because if I'm always thinking that way, I am more likely to capture an opportunity to help myself or to help others. Otherwise, I'm going to miss something. So it's a life choice. So people that are true connectors, they think like this all the time. It's not, you know, it's not a switch. It's not just, well, you know, the spirit moves me. It's just who you are. And I know when I meet somebody, if they're a connector, within just a few seconds, I get that vibe. If they're not, or they're on a different wave or a different level of thinking, I get that vibe too.
Well, Pian, you said that. Tell me who your ultimate client or customer is.
Well, I speak
for Michael Goldberg.
Yeah, well, I speak nationally and sometimes internationally on the concept of networking and generating referrals. So my niche market, and this is important because it's a big concept that I share with audiences and share with people that I'm working with to help them be successful at this whole networking connecting thing, is financial services, which is very broad. Insurance agents, financial planners, advisors, brokers, wholesalers in the life insurance industry, annuities, mutual funds, the wirehouses. That's a big market for me. 99% of my work is there. And the reason is because they need to know how to do this networking connecting thing, or they're just not going to succeed. 9 out of 10 financial advisors fail in their business. 9 out of 10, 90% fail. Why do they fail? Because they don't see enough people. Why don't they see enough people? Because they don't know how to network properly. They don't know the ins and outs. They just don't realize that it's a process. They don't realize it's the switch always on, the peripherals always wide. So I'm a little bit of a name in that marketplace, which is to say I've been doing it a long time there.
What about bankers?
Some, not a lot in banking. It's a different dynamic, I think, because bankers, they're really looking at commercial lending and that type of thing. And I don't know how this is going to sound, but they get compensated in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
Commercial lenders, they get a salary and they get a commission. But life insurance agents and financial advisors, they typically don't get a salary. They eat what they kill. So if they don't know how to make a connection, they don't get paid. They don't make a living, right? So the people that are on 100% commission and need to know how to meet more and better people through connections is really a fruitful market for me, because they need to know what it is that I'm sharing with them.
And what has boxing done for your confidence?
You know what boxing has done for my own confidence? I don't know from a speaking standpoint, but I have to tell you from a confrontational standpoint, when I'm facing a challenge, is there's no greater challenge that I have faced, I don't think, than some guy in the other end of the ring that I don't know that wants nothing more than to stove my head in. And we were talking about this earlier, is that you have to have a certain mindset to be able to accept that. And for a nice guy like me that likes to meet people and connect and help, to flip that switch and now be the other guy that I have to be able to defend myself and be able to, you know, punch somebody with bad intentions. So to overcome that and be able to deal with that, I would say that it's helped me deal with a lot of other aspects in my life, because it kind of pales in comparison in many ways. You know, just battles that I have. You know, my parents are older. My mom is sick. Dealing with a dad that's got a temper and that's angry at the world and that type of thing, and trying to roll with that a little bit. So, I mean,
you need to put him in the boxing ring.
Well, you know what? I think he'd beat me up. I tell you, he's a retired New York City police officer. I mean, I think he'd smack me around pretty good at 77 years old, you know. But even the non-physical fights, I try to look at a strategic way. I don't always do this. I don't always handle it the best way. But thinking strategically, like, what's my fight plan for this? And that's kind of what I go back to even in the book, is what's my fight plan? What's your fight plan for, you know, creating a prospect, for generating a referral, for landing a client, for solving a problem? You know, what's your fight plan, and are you working that plan every day?
What about that story I told you about with the young lady who I watched came into this networking event, and she went around and passed her cards out, boom, boom. Let me give you a card. She looked around. Oh, did I get everybody?
Yeah, she thought she was in Atlantic City. Yeah, she
right.
Thought, yeah.
So now, what happened? I'm sure, because I didn't reach out to her. I didn't call her, but probably she got no connections. Right. So she's gonna say networking doesn't work.
Right, because she got no connections because she didn't make a connection. She was just like a card dealer at Atlantic City. She was just throwing cards out there, right? So that's not really connecting. That's not relational. That's transactional. That's, here's my card, call me so I can sell you something. So with experienced networkers, with experienced connectors, that doesn't float.
Yeah. Yeah, people that's good about what they do. Wow. This is an excellent knockout networking. This is an excellent concept. And how's it done for your business as far as speaking is concerned?
Well, I mean, it's been great. I've been in business for 15 years, but as soon as I rebranded and really became known as the knockout networking guy, or sometimes the boxer guy, the boxer networking guy, get him in here. It's transformed my business in a lot of ways. So from a marketing standpoint, people can understand better who I am, what I do, what I bring to this. And it's also, I think, personifies my style when I'm in front of an audience, is I tend to be in your face. I tend to be very, very close. I'm direct with my language. I'm very, very succinct. I'm told I'm pretty dynamic, high energy. And I want to think that I'm some of those things when I'm in the ring as well. But when you're dealing with financial advisors and salespeople that get antsy in an audience, because all they want is, they just want an idea. They want a tool that's going to help them make money. Otherwise, they'll walk out on you. They don't want to be there because everybody's in front of these guys. So you really got to be on your game. Otherwise, they're going to open up newspapers. They're going to pick up cell phones. They're going to tune out on you. My job is I have to create a connection. It's the same thing with an audience. If you don't have a connection, man, nothing else matters. You know, it doesn't matter what you say. You need that connection. And I'll give you a quick example. I spoke at a university yesterday morning, and this wasn't even college students. This was high school students that just graduated that were now going to go into college. And it was this big program to prep them. And these students had to be prepared for this in order to qualify for this program. So there was 90 students. So in essence, they're high school students. They haven't even gone to a college class yet. And my job was to make a connection with them because, you know, I think salespeople have a short attention span. You know, look at a high school student, man. You know, if you don't catch them in 3-4 seconds, man, they're texting, tweeting, twitting. They're in a different world. You've lost them. They're on Instagram. You know, they're done with you. So my goal was I needed to get them, you know, in the first minute, first second, first, I needed to get them going. Because otherwise, it was over. So I just started, you know, just asking them questions right out of the gate. There's five reasons why people network. What are they? And back and forth, and I created this sort of virtual sparring thing going on where all of a sudden
virtual sparring.
Yeah, they were participating with me and I got them laughing. I have some of these things that I think are pretty funny. They might have thought it was funny, but I had the connection. So now once I had them going, I was able to take them into a different place. Without doing that, especially with high school kids, talk about a tough group, you know, you're not going anywhere. It's always about the connection.
Always about the connection. So in my opinion, I think someone that would write a book about network, knockout networking, and putting together these two concepts, I think that's a little crazy.
I've been called worse, but yeah.
I think that's a little crazy. Knockout networking, a guy with a suit on and boxing gloves, even though I took a picture of that, I think that's crazy. Let me show you what I mean by crazy.
Here's to the crazy ones. The misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can't do is ignore them, because they change things. They push the human race forward. While some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
You got to be crazy to write a book on knockout network. You got to be crazy. What do you think about that?
A little bit. You know, the reality is there's nothing new under the sun. There's really no new concepts. But if you can put positioning around a concept where it reaches somebody, it reaches an audience, it's memorable, it's visual, people can refer to it, you've got something.
So when did you first start speaking?
I started speaking, yeah, that's a good question. I started speaking in, I want to say 1990-ish.
So this is before the boxing?
Yeah, way before the boxing, yeah. So I started speaking. I was, I got involved in training and development. And in fact, there's a story behind this. I've got 20 years as a restaurant manager, as a restaurant operator. So I ran a restaurant, and ultimately I ran a bunch of restaurants and high energy and all that stuff. And I was really good at it. And so I used to get asked to come to some of the big meetings. And this is as like a 20-something, you know, that I was old man now. But so I used to, get asked to go to these meetings and share what I was doing, you know, within, you know, my territory because, you know, the numbers are pretty good. So I would speak at these meetings and I created a little bit of fanfare, but I was too young and naive to realize that. And I kept getting invited to these meetings. And as a young kid, really, I was being put on an airplane. And my thinking was, let me get this straight. So you're going to continue to pay me my salary, which wasn't bad for somebody my age. You're going to put me on a plane. So you're going to pay for that. You're going to pay for my hotel. I get to get up in front of a whole bunch of people, share some of the things that I think are working. They kind of have to do it. And then I get to hang out and have a good time and party with these people. And I still get paid. This is really not a bad deal. So it turned into twice a year, which transformed into every quarter that they were flying me someplace. And there was a guy named Mike Shipley, who I have not been able to track down, even through social media, but a guy based in Texas. And he was a senior VP of learning and development for one of the restaurant chains that I had worked for. And I got to tell you, he changed my life because he was about the best speaker I'd ever seen at that time. And I wanted to be Mike Shipley. So I remember asking if he would have lunch with me, you know, during one of the breaks. Here I am networking. I didn't even know it. So I have lunch with Mike Shipley, and I said, you know, you're like my idol. I want to be you. How does that happen? What was your career track? Could you tell me? And he shared that it was similar to where I was going, and he said, Michael Goldberg, I want to be you. He said, do you have any idea what you do when you get up in front of these people? Like, you're talking about boring things like inventory control and labor management and all this like nonsense. He said, and you make it entertaining. You make great points. You're funny. People are taking notes. He's like, you take all of this, energy, and you kind of put it together into something. That's why you keep getting invited back. He said, you need to speak professionally. I said, you could do that? And that's what started it. Like, I didn't know what that was. You know, it just, you know, well, if you keep bringing me out here, but he saw something bigger, you know, that I didn't see at the time. But that turned into me eventually leaving the restaurant industry, going back to school, getting some letters at the end of my name, and understanding or getting a better understanding of training and development, really what that meant. So I ended up working for, I got out of the restaurant industry, ended up working for a pretty big company called Staples, and worked for them, had a pretty good role with them. And then I got recruited by a speaking and training company that was Boston-based, and I brought in a lot of business. And when I saw that I could bring in a lot of business for a consulting firm that wasn't mine, I started thinking, imagine if it was mine. So in July of 2000, I just celebrated my 15-year anniversary, I started my own shop. And the rest, as they say. And so I learned a lot just by having those conversations and asking the right questions. Because if you don't ask the right question, you don't get the right answer. In fact, if you don't ask the question, the answer is always no.
Well, speaking of question, how did you know that networking would be the niche for you?
You know, when I got started, I didn't. When I got started, I would deliver a program or a training or a talk on anything anybody would pay me for. I'm telling you, right? When you're new, right? When you don't really have it figured out. Now, I was doing a lot of this stuff anyway for different companies, so I wasn't going in unprepared. But I was speaking about all different topics, all different levels of leadership, customer service, guest relations, a lot of human resource topics, sexual harassment prevention actually became a bit of a niche topic for me because I had a pretty good background in resolving issues in that area for one of the companies I had worked for and within the restaurants and all that. So pretty much anything under the sun in the world of soft skills, if I was able to pull content together and deliver it effectively, I would take that gig. But I knew that networking was the only way I was going to get more business and get more gigs. And I knew networking was about connecting with people, and I love speaking to people. So a lot of it came easily to me, and I guess I didn't realize how easily. To me, it was just if I help people get what they want and they're influential people, they're going to help me right back. And that was my only philosophy. And I did pretty good out of the gate. So after about a year and a half, I started getting bored. And when you're running your own business and you're getting bored with you, that's a problem. But I started getting bored. Like, I wasn't passionate about what I was doing just because I wasn't passionate about my topic. I had a niche. I stumbled upon a niche, which is to say I carved it out with police and fire departments because my dad's a retired New York City police officer, grew up kind of tough, and I thought that I was good in those environments. But they were draining environments. They weren't always positive. They weren't always upbeat. And here I was delivering content that I wasn't passionate about, and I was in an environment that I wasn't passionate about. That's a bad business model. And I'm just saying. And then I got a call out of the blue by a guy that is a regional director for a networking organization called BNI, which is Business Networking International.
I interviewed Ivan Meisner at least three times.
Yeah. So Ivan Meisner, the founder of BNI, yeah. But so this regional director basically hired me to speak at his Northeast regional thing. So I did this talk, and something happened when I did that talk. He wanted me to speak about networking and referrals, and I had never spoken about that professionally before. Like, when we were setting this up, my response was, I really said this. I said, networking, isn't it just something you do? I said that. And he said, well, he laughed. He thought I was joking. So I kind of laughed along with him, like, you know. But he wanted me to do this talk on networking, and I just thought it was just something I did. I didn't think there was a process to it. Like, really, you want me to talk about that? So I just made a list of two lists. I made a list of all the things that I thought I did well from a networking standpoint, which wasn't very big. And then I made this huge list of all the things I wasn't very good at, huge. And I did this talk in front of a lot of people on these are some things that I do well, these are some things I don't do well, but that you should do well. And I just pulled this talk together, and something happened on that stage on July 2nd of 2002 that changed my whole world, because all of a sudden there was a connection. There was a connection with me and the audience. There was a connection with my topic. And everything changed right there on stage where I realized I need to do this more. So I found my topic, but I didn't find my niche. I had hundreds of small business owners in front of me. But I thought, who needs this message that can pay for it and that has meetings all the time and that puts people in a room that are like me, high energy, type A, driven, all that? Became financial services. And it was an interesting time because this was 2002, And I had researched that in 2003, the Federal Trade Commission was going to roll out in October the Do Not Call list. So I thought if the financial services industry didn't need me now, in 03, they're really going to need me. And I built my whole campaign around that, and everything changed.
Wow, that's an interesting story. So we're almost going to take a break. Halfway done.
Are you kidding me?
Halfway
so,
done.
So a little cut man action on the corner? A little break?
Yeah, take a little break. Let me set this up real quick. I mean, this is. Are you enjoying yourself?
I am having a blast.
All right, that's good. That is awesome.
Other than it being 6 in the morning and all that, you know.
Time is just time.
Yeah, I'd be in my third mile by about now, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, time is just time. That's all it is just time. So we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to get back, and we're going to continue having fun and enjoying this amazing interview.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, are you ready? The New York Empowerment Summer 2015, presented by Glory of God Christian Center, is here at the world's most famous arena, Madison Square Garden Amphitheater. Labor Day weekend, Saturday, September the 5th, and Sunday, September the 6th. Guest speakers, Dr. Roderick Caesar, Dr. Jasmine Scholar, Bishop Tudor Bismarck, Reverend Margaret Elaine Flakes, with more to be added. Artists appearing, Ty Tribbett, Dorinda Clark Cole, Tasha Cobb, Bishop Hezekiah Walker, Pastor Shirley Caesar, Pastor Marvin Sapp, CeCe Wyman, Uchi Agu, Kevin Downswell, Marva Providence, Marty Munizzi, Wes Morgan, and more. You can purchase your pre-sale discount tickets at Ticketmaster.com or at Madison Square Garden box office number 866-858-0008. Information on Saturday, September the 5th's conferences and workshop facilitators, you can call NewYorkEmpowerMentSummit.com at 877-354-9036. This is Dalton Anderson, your MC for the New York Empowerment Summit 2015 at the world's most famous arena, Madison Square Garden.
WHCR 90.3 FM will broadcast live from Harlem Week 2015. On Saturday, August 15th, from 12 noon to 5 p.m., we will broadcast in front of Gallery M, located at 123 West 135th Street, between Lenox Avenue and Adam Clayton Powell Jr. Boulevard. Your favorite DJs will spin the latest tunes. Come meet them and your favorite talk show host. On Sunday, August 16th, from 12 noon to 5 p.m., we will broadcast in front of the Harlem Hospital Center, located at 135th Street at the corner of Lenox Avenue. The host of Health in Harlem, Maurice Selby and Sean Shivers, will take their show to the streets of Harlem. They will talk to doctors from Harlem Hospital Center about health issues that affect our community. That's WHCR 90.3 FM's live broadcast during Harlem Week 2015, Saturday, August 15th, and Sunday, August 16th.
Hey, WHCR 90.3 FM New York listeners. We know you like to be informed, inspired, and entertained. That's why every Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday at 6 p.m., I, Joshua Bolden, will bring you your latest news and updates from national headlines, pop culture, news around the world, and issues that affect you and I here at home. It's WHCR News with Joshua Bolden, Tuesdays through Thursdays at 6 p.m. You don't want to miss it.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
You're listening to WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
It's WHCR, the voice of Harlem.
WHCR 90.3 FM will broadcast live from Harlem Week 2015. On Saturday, August 15th, from 12 noon to 5 p.m., we will broadcast in front of Gallery M, located at 123 West 135th Street, between Lenox Avenue and Adam Clayton Powell Jr. Boulevard. Your favorite DJs will spin the latest tunes. Come meet them and your favorite talk show host. On Sunday, August 16th, from 12 noon to 5 p.m., we will broadcast in front of the Harlem Hospital Center, located at 135th Street at the corner of Lenox Avenue. The host of Health in Harlem, Maurice Selby and Sean Shivers, will take their show to the streets of Harlem. They will talk to doctors from Harlem Hospital Center about health issues that affect our community. That's WHCR 90.3 FM's live broadcast during Harlem Week 2015, Saturday, August 15th, and Sunday, August 16th.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, are you ready? The New York Empowerment Summer 2015, presented by Glory of God Christian Center, is here at the world's most famous arena, Madison Square Garden at the theater. Labor Day weekend, Saturday, September the 5th, and Sunday, September the 6th. Guest speakers, Dr. Roderick Caesar, Dr. Jasmine Scholar, Bishop Tudor Bismarck, Reverend Margaret Elaine Flakes, with more to be added. Artists appearing, Ty Tribbett, Dorinda Clark Cole, Tasha Cobb, Bishop Hezekiah Walker, Pastor Shirley Caesar, Pastor Marvin Sapp, CeCe Winans, Uchi Agu, Kevin Downswell, Marva Providence, Martha Munizzi, Wes Morgan, and more. You can purchase your pre-sale discount tickets at Ticketmaster.com or at Madison Square Garden box office number 866-858-0008. Information on Saturday, September the 5th's conferences and workshop facilitators, you can call NewYorkEmpowerMentSummit.com at 877-354-9036. This is Dalton Anderson, your MC for the New York Empowerment Summit 2015 at the world's most famous arena, Madison Square Garden.
Of the spiritual forces with which all of us are blessed. And it was in this field that I came upon a clue which has enabled me to help millions of people to find their earthly destinies. I want to describe my discovery in the simplest terms possible, because it will reveal to you why it is true that whatever the mind can conceive and believe, the mind can achieve, regardless of how many times you may have failed in the past or how lofty your aims and hopes may be. I caught my first fleeting glimpse of the profound law which my search led me to the study of the spiritual forces with which all of us are blessed. And it was in this field that I came upon a clue which has enabled me to help millions of people to find their earthly destinies. I want to describe my discovery in the simplest terms possible, because it will reveal to you why it is true that whatever the mind can conceive and believe, the mind can achieve, regardless of how many times you may have failed in the past or how lofty your aims and hopes may be. I caught my first fleeting glimpse of the profound law which provides the means by which we may choose our own purpose in life and attain it while I was being coached by Andrew Carnegie during the organization of the Science of Success philosophy. I had just finished telling Mr. Carnegie that I feared he had chosen the wrong person to give the world the first practical...
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
My lack of education and my lack of finances. Well, at this point, Mr. Carnegie delivered a lecture that I shall never forget, because it changed my entire life and paved the way for my helping to change the lives of millions of people, some of them not yet born. Let me call your attention to a great power which is under your control, said Mr. Carnegie, a power which is greater than poverty, greater than the lack of education, greater than all of your fears and superstitions combined. It is the power to take possession of your own mind and direct it to whatever ends you may desire. This profound power, Mr. Carnegie continued, is the gift of the Creator, And it must have been considered the greatest of all of his gifts to man, because it is the only thing over which man has the complete and unchallengeable right of control and direction. When you speak of your poverty and lack of education, Mr. Carnegie explained, you are simply directing your mind power to attract these undesirable circumstances, because it is true that whatever your mind feeds upon, your mind attracts to you. Now you see why it is important that you recognize that all success begins with definiteness of purpose, with a clear picture in your mind of precisely what you want from life. Then Mr. Carnegie continued his speech with a description of a great universal truth which made such an impact upon my mind that I began then and there to give myself a new outlook on life, and set up for myself a goal so far above my previous achievements that it shocked my friends and relatives when they heard about it. Everyone, said Mr. Carnegie, comes to the earth plane blessed with the privilege of controlling his mind power and directing it to whatever ends he may choose. But, he continued, everyone brings over with him at birth the equivalent of two sealed envelopes, one of which is clearly labeled the riches you may enjoy if you take possession of your own mind and direct it to ends of your own choice. And the other is labeled the penalties you must pay if you neglect to take possession of your mind and direct it. And now let me reveal to you, said Mr. Carnegie, the contents of those two sealed envelopes. In the one labeled riches is this list of blessings. 1, sound health. 2, peace of mind. 3, a labor of love of your own choice. 4, freedom from fear and worry. 5, a positive mental attitude. 6, material riches of your own choice and quantity. In the sealed envelope labeled penalties, Mr. Carnegie continued, is this list of the prices one must pay for neglecting to take possession of his own mind. 1, ill health. 2, fear and worry. 3, indecision and doubt. 4, frustration and discouragement throughout life. 5, poverty and want. 6, and a whole flock of evils consisting of envy, greed, jealousy, anger, hatred, and superstition.
Wow, man, Napoleon Hill, he was really dropping some amazing science there. I really love how Napoleon Hill was teaching these wonderful success principles. And Mike, as you said, he was doing this back in the, you know, the 20s,
he was doing
30s.
This in the 20s, yeah. And when you listen to what he's saying, I mean, yeah, timely, but also, you know, timeless, I think, in a lot of ways. They still apply today. You can still listen to it.
Absolutely. 100%. I love the work that Napoleon Hill did. Very, very good. Very powerful. changed a lot of lives. I mean, people like Tony Robbins, as you mentioned, Stephen Covey. A lot of these people studied Napoleon Hill.
Yeah, he kind of paved the way for a lot of them. And Carnegie paved the way for him.
That's right. Carnegie, yeah. Man, imagine having a mentor like Andrew Carnegie. Yeah. But and so how was your physical? You're in pretty good shape. You work out? I heard you talk about CrossFit.
Yeah, I mean, you know, for an old guy that's brittle, I do okay. I try to work out 6 days a week if I can. So I do the boxing thing. So I've got a pro that trains me, Imamu Mayfield, former IBF cruiserweight champ, 25-9, 19 knockouts. How you doing? But he's my guy, and one day I think the two of you will meet. But so I train with him once or twice a week with you know, some sparring, but a lot of glove work, and depending on what we're doing. But so he's right. Got me on a program. I do CrossFit 3 days a week, so I do that on my own, where there's a lot of kettlebell work and a lot of powerlifting, and there's some running in there, and that's pretty grueling for those that know what CrossFit is. It's a kind of a world unto itself. And then on top of it, I do some running, do my own road work, and I've got a gym 5 minutes from my house. So I try to do my own you know, my own weight work, you know, a lot of bench and a lot of, you know, sort of the bigger muscle group exercises. So I try to get once or twice a day, 6 days a week around my travel schedule and everything else. So I try to keep on my game.
So I want to show you something real quick.
Take a look at this. I'm nervous. Now I'm nervous.
Yeah? Don't be nervous. You're good. You're in good hands.
Yeah, all right.
What's in your hand? You're in good hands.
What's in your hand? I see that. That's not Napoleon Hill anymore.
No. But it's all inspiration.
And when you spiral through the atmosphere, all they see is motion. They never see the tears. They never feel the pain. They always think it's nothing, but it's something such a shame. But there is no romance in life that's on the ledge. And there's no one to talk you down and tuck you in the bed, Lord.
Loving her on the jump rope, that's cool.
Or something for the books or the bars. To bob your head and nod, I recall. So many never ever thought you'd make it. So sad they were mistaken. The joy they tried to take it, mama said it. The best thing you can do and be is you. This world ain't got but once, so give credit where it is due. Ain't that the truth? And here you are, a black unicorn. Mythical, mystical since the day that you were born. A place where you can go, no one else is allowed. Sitting up on your cloud, so high when you look down. Just glance upon the beauty and the wonder to be found. Then know that you can stop your search, cause love is all around.
Free at last, free at last.
All right.
She was fun to watch in the finals. I don't know if you caught that, but she was just dominant, just unreal.
Really?
Yeah. Wimbledon, I think she just backed out of the Swedish Open to an injury, but I think she's prepping for U.S. Open. But okay. Just unbelievable. Just a phenom on the court. I mean, she seems to get better with age. It's incredible.
Well, I mean, look at her workout. You just saw her workout. Yeah. Very intense.
Yeah.
So that's very important. You know, being physically fit. How's that helped you with your speaking career, being physically fit and working out?
Well, obviously in the ring, it's been very beneficial. You know, a lot of the kids I'm in the ring with are half my age and all that stuff. So to be able to try to keep up with them, I got to keep up with my own fitness level. But on the stage, I think what it does is it gives me a lot of, I mean, certainly energy to do what I do, but also a lot of credibility. Since I do talk about boxing and I talk about training and I talk about all these different things and I relate it to business, I think if I look a certain way and I look like I'm taking care of myself, I think what it does is it feeds into the message that I'm delivering about being more, better, connecting, all this stuff. I think it just resonates. You know, if I didn't look a certain way and I'm talking about boxing and training and being your best, I'm not sure that message would be as strong, would be as credible. You know, I'd be pulling my punches there.
Mm. Who's the greatest networker you ever saw?
The greatest? I mean, besides you? The greatest networker I ever saw. That's a good question. I don't know. I've got a business partner. I've got another business venture that I do right here in New York City where we started a networking group. And her name is Cynthia Greenewalt. I would say she's pretty good. She might be one of the best, if not the best, that I've seen, just because of she teaches a similar message to what I teach, and we formed a partnership. But she just seems to know everyone that you need to know in and around the city, and she's not even from here. She's only been here a handful of years and relocated from Florida, and some of the things that she's doing I think are pretty incredible.
So I went in this hotel yesterday downtown in Midtown on the east side, and this young lady was working in a little shop that they sell like things inside the hotel, drinks.
Yeah, yeah.
Food, you know, candy bars, yeah. And magazines. So I says, you know, you could be a millionaire. I says, and I'm showing her the book. I said, it's networking. I said, if you use your network, you learn how to network, you could be a millionaire. And we were talking. I was telling her about, you know, networking and everything. I said, well, let me ask you something. How did you get this job? Through networking.
Yes,
so you got the job through networking. So here it is. You got all these people walking around the city, possible millionaires that don't know how to maximize their networks. What do you say to these people that don't know how to maximize their networks?
Well, it kind of depends on where they're at, because you really have to have an openness to this. You know, I'd say you don't connect with everybody because everybody is not a connector necessarily. So I think you have to have a certain mindset. You have to think. And one of the mindsets that I try to suggest, and again, nothing new under the sun, but maybe something I'm trying to shine a brighter light on, is you have to be all about helping other people. If you're not about helping other people, no one's ever going to help you, right? So that's kind of like the jab. The jab setting up the right. You know, you've got to really, and not to sound manipulative, but you have to, that's got to be in your heart. You got to be all about helping people and helping the right people achieve what it is that they're looking for, whether it's landing a job, learning something, make more friends, or landing business or whatever it is. Because if that's your mindset, they're going to help you right back. You know, and that's really where a connection comes from. So those that don't think that way aren't going to really get it, you know, and that's fine. In fact, I have a mathematical way of looking at this is I find that if I'm not speaking at the event, but I'm at somebody's event or I'm at a cocktail party or somewhere and I'm doing this networking thing, if I meet 10 people, I probably only really connect with 3 of them, 3 of 10. So that's a third. I refer to that as the one-thirder dynamic. So it's like you and I think this is a one-thirder connection. We connected, you had me at hello, right? But the other 7 or so, the other two-thirds, that's the two-thirder dynamic. Those are the people that there's just not a connection with. It's not bad. It's just what is. So what I like to suggest to business people, or really anybody looking for a job, is you got to focus on the one-thirders. You got to focus on the people that there's a natural connection with. Because without a connection, nothing else is really going to happen. And a lot of people miss that concept. And everybody doesn't get it. And it just starts really with your mindset. If your mindset is not going to be about that, it's just never going to come together for you.
When I look at my networking skills and I say I want to judge myself from 1 to 10, 1 being the lowest and 10 being the highest, I would rate my networking skills at a 4, at 40%.
Okay, because?
I have a huge, huge network, yeah. Worldwide.
Yeah.
Worldwide, nationwide. I would say 40% because there's certain things that I'm not doing in my network.
Okay.
Like one of the things is like following up, keeping in touch.
Right.
Sometimes, you know, I got so much going on, but that's not an excuse. So what do you say for someone that has a huge network like myself, and I'm rating myself at a 40% level? My goal is to take it to a 60, 70, right. 80% level. I mean, do you know anybody that's at 90 or 100?
You know, it's hard to
Be 90 or 100. Yeah.
It's really difficult. And again, I kind of pride myself on my network and all this stuff. And I think with social media the way it is, I think it's easier to stay in front of your network and to remain engaged and all this stuff. But the reality is you don't have to keep, and this is going to sound bad, but you don't have to keep up with everybody because everybody's, you know, life and careers and it all evolves, you know. So it's really just being able to identify the right people within your network that you're keeping up with. Yeah. So like in my world, those that are connected with my marketplace, so financial services and that industry and those that serve that industry, you know, not to mention friends, of course, but that becomes really my focal point. That's really where I, you know, try to do everything that I can to keep up to date, offer value, help, all those different things. Because, you know, the reality is, with knowing thousands and thousands of people, as you must as well, you really just can't keep up with everybody. But there are ways to do it. There are ways to go through your database. And I've got methods that I teach where every day I'm putting out a phone call or an email or a text in some cases as I'm going through my entire database A to Z. Of course, I don't do this every day. This is an ongoing thing. You know, where I'll as I'm sort of going through my database, I haven't spoken to Rick in a long time. Let me reach out to him and see what's going on. But by doing that, not only am I reconnecting, but I'm also refreshing my database and catching up on new contact information, new jobs, new phase in life, who got married, who got divorced, who did, you know, and all of a sudden, all kinds of great things come out of those conversations. And that's incredible. And this is not an overnight thing, and it's something very deliberate that I do, but it's piecemeal. So by the time I get through Z, it's now time to get back to A. So through my year, I'm always just trying to keep up with as many people as I can.
Right. Well, imagine, you know, someone's been on the show. I've had a lot of amazing guests on this show. But just say, for example, someone's been on the show, they're reaching out, they're keeping in touch. How you doing, Rick? How's everything? Not, I'm coming on to let you know I got a new book, a new program. Right, but I'm just checking on you and seeing how you're doing.
Yeah, how often does that happen, right?
Yeah. You see? So how is that going to play for me if someone's doing that? Sure. I'm going to say, they're going to be fresh in my mind.
Right.
When, you know, something comes up, bing.
Yeah, you got to make it about the other person, and it's got to be genuine. Mm-hmm. You know, so when I'm reaching out to people, it's not with anything in mind. Of course, I'm building a business. You know, but if I'm helping people build their business, I know they're going to help me right back. But often it's just to check in. What's going on with you? It's been a long time. It's interesting. I mean, I've got a concept called the A to Z list, my A to Z list. So it's simple. It's just simply going through your database A to Z, but it's plucking out clients, prospects, friends, and others that you have an ongoing relationship. It's all those other people that fall into this category, they fall into this abyss where we forget about them just because they're not top of mind. So that's what I'm looking for as I'm going through my list. And I've refreshed friendships when I was back in the 20s, back in the restaurant days, where we got together and we get together and it's like we never stopped getting together. We laugh over the same stuff. We have a blast. And I'm thinking, I got to do this more. And it costs nothing. And this is not an all-day thing. I mean, we've all got things to do. But this is every morning. I might make two or three phone calls or send two or three emails as I'm going through my list to people that I haven't spoken to in so long. And it's always fun. You always get those notes back, those calls back. It's unbelievable.
Is your wife a good networker?
I'd say my wife is a good networker. She's not in a role where there's business development or sales in mind. You know, she is a director of education for a title insurance company, but she's very good at working the room. She's really good at that part of it. And, so when she goes to events with me, you know, we participate in a lot of different things. She's great working the room and putting people in touch. She's a good connector. So I'd say she's good, although she doesn't need to be necessarily in her role. But she definitely has a certain swagger to her. She's got an energy. People like her. I want to say she's kind of cute. All that. that doesn't hurt, you know. I know she's listening, but all that stuff.
What's her name?
Her name is Lainey.
Lainey. Hey, Lainey, how you doing? How's the networking skills, Lainey?
No, she's all right. Good. She's good.
All right.
And she also makes sure I mind my manners, too. If there's something that I'm missing, she might remind me. So she's good like that, too, to have in my corner.
And you need that. You need that.
No question.
That's very important.
You can't go it alone.
Yeah. Yeah. That's it. Wow. This is good. So, I mean, when you wrote this book, what was the message that you wanted to get out? Like, what was the main message you wanted to get out from writing this book?
Well, the main thing is that I speak a lot and I share a lot of what I think are important concepts because they've worked for me. And if they can work for me, they're going to work for anybody. But it was really just getting my ideas out there. And if you can, you know, as a speaker and as a consultant and as an educator, you know, the whole deal is trying to get your ideas out there in a number of different ways, you know, whether it's through speaking, whether it's through social media, whether it's through a book. Whether it's through other medium, but there are people that are avid readers. Of course, there's a credibility thing having a book, but I wanted people to be able to, you know, to work on some of the concepts that I'm sharing. And then, oh, by the way, when I have clients say, you know, we'd like to buy your book for all of our agents not having one, that ain't a good thing. That's happened more than once where I've had firms or organizations want to buy my book for everybody, where it's hundreds of books. I don't have one. So okay. I thought I need content for them to be able to to reinforce and share the ideas.
Are you good at marketing?
I am, yeah.
You're good at marketing. Yeah. All right, good. I think Lainey's going to agree with me on this next thing I'm going to say to you.
Or not.
I think Lainey's going to agree with me.
Okay.
See, I'm a boxer, so she's got to agree with me.
Yep.
So anyway, two things I think that this should be in audio. Have you done that yet?
It's not an audio, no.
But I think you should do this book in audio.
I do have an audio product that talks about these concepts. So it's not the audio book per se, but it's another program that covers a lot of these concepts that are in audio. So agreed. Okay. Yeah.
But I think this should be an audio book.
Yeah.
Knockout Networking.
Yeah.
I think it'll do very well.
Yeah, I think so. I think you can have me back on the show and I can promote it.
Well, I mean, you're going to be back anyway.
Yes.
You know, anyway, so... I think this would be good audio. The other thing I think is good, this is just for me, and I started to bring them and I didn't. They got these little chat pocketbooks. You can just slip in your mm-hmm. I think you should do like a mini Knockout Networking, a mini.
Like a mini book?
A mini book.
Ah, okay.
And also there's another thing that they have is these, I forgot what they call these cards, these mem cards.
Mm-hmm.
Like a deck of cards.
Right.
And principles.
Ah.
So you can do the deck of cards and then also the little mini book.
Yeah.
So, because like, you know, some people in their pocket, they go into a meeting.
Sure.
I could just kind of you know, had these principles with me all the time.
Right. Well, it's kind of interesting. In the second chapter of the book, I cover the rules of networking.
Okay.
And I kind of liken them to the pool rules. Like, ever go to a public pool and you see all the pool rules that are there on the fence and it's all the stuff you can't do?
Okay.
Well, everybody knows what the pool rules are, right? You can't eat. You know, you can, no broken glass, no running, no swimming, no fun, you know, all that stuff. So I thought, you know, and it's got to be there, you know, in the States and in Canada too, because Board of Health dictates that it should be, OSHA dictates that it should be. So I thought, since everybody knows what the rules are, since they're everywhere, I thought if I wrote rules for networking, like the pool rules of networking, as I call them, I thought if people devote them to memory, that would be pretty cool, because then we'd remember some of these rules. We'd remember the do's and the don'ts. So I actually have a bookmark that I give out to audiences that have all 23 of the rules on them. You know, so even my audience yesterday with the students, you know, they all had that. So now they have a bookmark some branding on it and everything else. This way it's designed as a safekeep and as a cheat sheet. So if you're at an event, a cocktail party, an alumni event, an association meeting or whatever, you've got this little cheat sheet that you can refer to.
Yeah, because I think like with this concept, you could run not all the way to the bank. I mean, with this. I mean, because like how Chicken Soup for the Soul, they wrote this one book, and then it just, I think right now they're up to like 500 million books or something crazy like that. Mm-hmm. Some crazy. So, I mean, I think you could do the same thing. You know, guerrilla marketing.
Yeah, little Chicken Soup for the Network, I think, you know.
Yeah, he took that, they did a networking. No, they didn't. Guerrilla Marketing did a network. Guerrilla Networking. Yeah. So you could really run with this. This is good. So give me one of the pool rules.
You want a pool rule. So yeah. One is...
Networking pool rule.
Networking pool rule. So one of my faves is no selling ever. No selling ever, ever, never. So it's not about going to a cocktail party or a networking event and selling a product or a service. So I tell a story, you know, in the book and very often from the stage about being at an event and, you know, being introduced to somebody. And I'm going to call him Dave because, you know, that's his name. And Dave is a mortgage guy. And the conversation turned into him trying to sell me a refinance.
Oh.
You know, as we started talking.
Well, like I did with you, right?
Yeah. You know, so, you know, do you own a home? You know, what's your mortgage rate? That type of thing. And that's all he wanted to do was to help me refinance my home.
Wow.
So I kind of pushed back a little bit. And, you know, because that's not networking. You know, that's hunting. Hunting versus farming. So that's going to a networking event and acting like a salesperson. So not to say that sales is bad, it's not, it's necessary, but there's a time and place for that. And what Dave didn't know, and what a lot of hunters or salespeople maybe don't realize, is that's about the connection. It always comes back to that, right? It's about once you make a connection and you're able to establish how you might help one another, you know, that person might turn into a prospect, ultimately into a client. But the aim shouldn't be to make them that out of the gate, because it's just not gonna go well. It's like showing up to a baseball field, you know, to watch your kid play, and you show up in like boxing gear, you know, like you're gonna stand out, and it's not gonna be good, right? They're gonna think that you're crazy, and people aren't gonna talk to you, you know. And it's kind of like that, showing up to a networking event with sales gear on, just doesn't work.
Yeah, I had one guy come to the studio once. I was interviewing him, and there was a lady here, and she was a business lady. And he was talking about, I mean, it was, I'm looking at him like, I can't believe he's saying this. He's telling all the things that he wants to do to help him and his family, which is okay.
Yeah.
But it was all about him and what he wanted. Right. I'm just watching him like, oh, that's interesting.
Uh-huh.
And I don't think he's been back since.
Probably not.
Yeah.
Probably not. Yeah. Because it just doesn't resonate. You know, it doesn't create a connection. It doesn't create a rapport. And we all know people that are like that, that they just talk about themselves and it's all about them. And you know what? That gives me stories to tell. That gives me content to share on the stage, you know, which is my sixth reason for networking is I'm looking for my next blog. I'm looking for my next story. I'm looking for my next learning point. Because, you know, when you go to events and you meet people, you can't make this stuff up. All types of goofy things happen and you got to share it with people.
So when you get on stage, what are you going to say about this radio interview?
I don't know.
Boxing in the studio,
I'm
man.
I'm still a little fuzzy from the left hook.
Yeah. All right. How's your defense as far as boxing is concerned?
Not good enough. I've got a kind of a high peekaboo, elbows in, you win, Mike Tyson guard. Very Mike Tyson-esque I try to be. because he's kind of my guy, but probably not as good as it should be. You know, I'm kind of, my hands are always up very high. I can throw very high, and because of my size and my stature, I tend to be shorter. I'm 5'9", but I tend to be a bit shorter as a light heavyweight than my opponent. So my inside style, my high guard tends to work well. I want to think that it kind of protects my head. It protects, you know, upstairs.
Well, my belief is that the most important punch in boxing is the jab.
Mm-hmm. Agreed, yeah.
And so what would be the jab as far as networking is concerned?
Well, the jab is to always find out about other people, is to ask great questions. I'd say that would be my jab. So if I was meeting somebody for the first time, Rick, very nice to meet you, man. Right. So, you've got a great energy. So tell me about you and what you do. Oh, you got a radio show. That's great. So how did you get that start? I would just come up, and it's not shtick. You know, it's not I'm just, like, making stuff up. Like, I'm genuinely interested in learning about other people. So I start to ask those questions. What I find, if you connect with a one-thirder, somebody where there's a true connection, as I had mentioned before, they start counterpunching with, how about yourself? How'd you get started? And now you're in the throes of, and this is a really difficult word, a conversation. Now you're in the throes of a conversation, because it's just a back and forth, and more likely that you're going to load that connection up and then figure out ways of helping one another. And then you're just doing it, man. Look at me. I'm doing it. I'm in the ring. I'm doing it. You know, and so it starts, that's the jab. You got to start by asking great questions. And if you get great questions, you get great answers. And very often that person says, well, how about yourself? And now you're in the throes of something great.
Right, that's right. Building that connection. So tell me about the flight plan, the networking flight plan system.
Well, I got a fight plan. Everything to me is a fight plan. So it's, to me in sales, it's having a daily fight plan. Or you can have a quarterly fight plan, you know. But to me, having a fight plan, like a fighter, you know, like Tyson getting in the ring, like he had a plan. It didn't work out so well with Buster Douglas, but he had a plan with pretty much everybody else. And I
loved that fight.
That was an interesting fight. Yeah, yeah, Buster Douglas was on a different planet that night.
Yeah,
his mom passed away, and he was just in a different place. And Tyson didn't have his corner, hadn't fought for a year and a half. And there was all kinds of stuff, but it was
in Japan,
right? But an interesting fight to watch. But you have to have a daily fight plan where you're going to make a certain amount of calls.
So you're not winging it.
No, you can't. You just can't. Some people are good enough to do that, but it catches up with you. Mm-hmm. But for every time that I happen to be in the office and not traveling, I have a list. I have a very specific plan that I follow in terms of the amount of calls that I make, the type of calls that I make, what I do on social media, who I'm reaching out to and why, who I'm helping. So I've just got this list. And that's one of the ways I help financial advisors, is I help them to create their own fight plan as it relates to their world so they can make more and better connections.
Mm. And since you've written this book, what was the response that gave you the most joy that you heard since you've written this book?
Well, what always gives me the most joy, and it's less about the book and it's more about the concepts that are in the book, is that I teach a public speaking class at Rutgers University.
Okay.
So this is just a Monday night gig before I'm off of the week. And I've been doing this for 11 years already. My gosh, time just flies. So now I'm working with, 18, 19, 20-year-olds, and they don't all get the book, but, sometimes I'll give a book away, and I teach some of the networking concepts to the students, because in the day, now it's Instagram and social media, that's all they know. The students don't know how to talk to people. So what gives me the greatest joy is when I share some of these concepts in class that, oh, by the way, they get on the midterm and they get on the final. But when they go out into the world and they actually do these things, because I have them for 15 weeks, called a semester, when they come back throughout the semester or email me after the class is over and they say that they landed an interview or an internship or a job because of something that I taught or something that they read or was shared in the class, man, it doesn't get any better than that. It just doesn't. Or they rattle off the pool rules to me, man. That's just beautiful.
Wow. That's pretty cool.
Like, for a business person to do it, that's one thing. But for, like, an 18, 19-year-old to take this, that knows they don't know how to do this, and to actually do it, unbelievable. I just saw like, the glimmer in the eyes yesterday. I spoke at an event where these are high school students that are just now getting into college. you know, not to say I got everybody, but there were some people that just had this look in their eye, like they just couldn't wait to try this, and they were just jotting notes down and lists of people that they needed to now talk to in a different way. And the questions that I got, it was amazing. I mean, these kids are going to actually do some of this stuff.
Right. So every boxing coach is different. They might start you off, they might give you the steps, how to step left, right, step, maybe how to jab, basic stuff. So what would, let me take a station ID.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rick Young, another segment of What's in Your Hand. And I'm here with the author, champion, author of Knockout Networking. Michael, you are truly a champion. Truly a champion. So let me just say, the first step, the basic fundamentals. Someone's starting out with their networking skills. Take me through the basic beginnings of how you're going to get somebody to improve their networking skills.
Well, for one thing, they have to understand what their purpose is. Like, why are you doing this? Why do you want to meet more and better people? Like, you have to have a purpose. And I meet people at events that they're not really sure what they want or what they're after. So what's your purpose? So for a student, what's in your hand? So for a student, it might be I'm looking to land a job. You know, for a business person, it might be I'm looking to generate more referrals and, you know, write more business, get more clients, the whole thing. But now it's, well, what type of clients? What type of job? What industry, profession, market segment, niche, dynamic, demographic, geography? You've got to get specifics, because as soon as you get the specifics down, now you'll know, and this is what networking is, now you'll know where you need to go, what you need to say, and with whom you need to say it. And that's your formula, and that's networking. You got to have the specifics. Now, I give a what I think is kind of a fun example in front of audiences is, so my 12-year-old Jessica, she's, what grade is she in? She's going to 7th grade. I should know this, right? Every now and then, help her with her homework, you know, and she's reducing fractions. You know, I think when I was in 6th grade, I don't think I was reducing fractions. Remember? Do you remember reducing fractions?
Not at all, no.
So luckily, she reminded me. But if you were going to take, and bear with me here, if you were going to take 4/8, reduce it to 2/4, to 1/2, there was an acronym that I learned, and it still exists today, called the least common denominator,
right,
the LCD, okay. Right? You reduce the fraction to the lowest or least common denominator. You know, these days, it's a TV, you know, it's a watch, you know? I think it's brilliant marketing. Because if you can take, so if I'm helping a student or a job searcher, and I'm helping them to take, well, I'm looking for a job, and I'm helping, that's 4/8. I want them to reduce it now to the lowest or least common denominator. What type of job? What industry? What profession? Market segment? Niche? Dynamic? Demographic? Name of company? Because once they figure that out, I can direct them on where they need to go, what they need to say, with whom they need to say it. Or I can say, you know what? I know somebody that works for that company. Would you like me to offer an introduction? If they don't mention the specifics and reduce that fraction, that conversation doesn't happen. So you got to get down to this. That's sort of like the foundation. You know, so the foundation is the jab. This is really the foundation of networking. So you have to have your purpose just focused. It's got to be specific. It's got to be succinct. And then after that, you have to execute the places to go, the things to say, and the people that you ultimately need to meet. And then the other side of it is now you have to have questions to talk to these folks. You need to have those questions. You need to be able to cultivate a conversation so you can learn about how you can help them. And then finally, you have to have a way of talking about you, your business, or your job search, or your focus in a way that makes the connection and has people understand what it is that you're after, because you're going to help them get what they're after. And it sounds really simple as I'm talking about it right now. It sounds so basic. It sounds like basic 101. Man, I got stories of very successful people that just don't know how to do this stuff, and they'd be so much more successful. Or job searchers. I volunteer to help job searchers all the time. And I don't mean just the kids, like, you know, because that's supposed to happen. But I mean the guy that needs to pay his mortgage that's an engineer, and all of a sudden the carpet was pulled out from under him, and he no longer has a job, and now he's got to be a salesperson. He's got to be a networker, even though he doesn't want to be. That's where my heart goes out to. There's people didn't ask for this.
We all in sales.
Oh, my gosh. But so, then helping them understand this is incredible.
So I like to do something. I like to try something a little different. How many minutes are in a round?
Yeah, three-minute round.
Three-minute round.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, you have a program on YouTube with three-minute round.
I do.
So here's what I want you to do. I want you to do, let's imagine, because imagination, Do you agree with this? Einstein said imagination is more important than knowledge.
I think imagination cultivates more knowledge for sure. But if you think you can and you can visualize what it is that you're after, sure. I mean, okay. You can always get the knowledge. Sure.
So what I'm after right now is I would like for you to imagine that you're on the stage in Madison Square Garden and you're going to do a presentation against 19,000 people, full house at Madison Square Garden.
So is this a fight or a presentation?
A presentation. Okay. A presentation on networking.
Okay.
But it's in the garden and it's in the ring.
All right. Okay.
And they're mostly fight fans, but you're going to talk to them about networking. So let me see. Let me get a clock. Let me get a timer. Let me get my timer out. We're going to do it. 3 minutes. I don't have a bell to ring. I don't have a bell, but I'll just go ding, ding, ding. So 3 minutes. We're going to do a 3-minute presentation on networking. Let me get my stopwatch here. Okay. Wait a minute, let me put the timer. There we go. So, all right, get in your corner. Get in the neutral corner. Here we are, champion of the world, Michael Goldberg of Knockout Networking, excuse me. Time.
All right, I'm on.
You're on.
I'm just talking. Okay. So boxing, like networking, is about the connection. The more and better connections you make, both in or out of the ring, the more successful you're going to be. What a lot of people do not realize is there's only five reasons why people network. Five reasons. To land business, or to write more business, and business could be recruiting, business could be some sort of fundraising, right? But any type of business, right? To more business, more sales. Land a job is a second reason why people network. Right, to land interviews, ultimately to land a job. Third reason why people network is social reasons, to make friends, to meet more boxers maybe. You know, I got involved in boxing just through networking and making a connection. To date, as in dating, right? I wish I knew this stuff when I was single, right? To date, or to meet the love of your life, right? So social reasons. Fourth reason why people network is to learn something. Learn about a product, learn about a service, learn about an industry, profession, market segment, niche, dynamic, demographic, geography. Or the fifth reason to network is to solve a very specific problem. A very specific problem. An example, my mom has a very rare form of Parkinson's disease. So some of my networking is aimed at understanding more about better meds and better doctors and treatments and that type of thing. My point, I live and breathe this stuff, baby. I live and breathe this stuff. I live and breathe making a connection. I can't think of any reasons that are more important than the five that I've just highlighted for you here. So what gets in the way? If it's so simple and you can solve almost all of life's problems through networking, why don't more people do it? Well, what I'm told is fear. Fear of failure. Fear of being rejected. Fear of the unknown. Fear of it not playing out the way that you want it to. Fear of not being liked. Fear of being wrong. Well, I'm here to tell you that if you approach networking the right way, there is nothing to fear because you have nothing to lose. My definition of networking, to boil it down, is networking is simply a proactive approach to meeting people. Proactive approach to meeting people to learn with the hopes of or with the prospect of helping them. It is not about pitching a product or service. It is not about talking about that you're looking to land a job. It's not handing out your resume. It's not handing out your business card to everybody that you meet. It's about learning about them and potentially helping the people that you can and the people that you like. Because if you spend your time learning from and helping the people that you like, they're going to just help you right back. And that's networking, baby. And that's
ding, 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 ding. That was 3 minutes.
On the money, baby.
There you go. Good, good, good. Wow, that was pretty good.
I've done this once or twice before.
Yeah, that was pretty good.
I try to put as much warfare into a 3-minute round as I can.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So, again, you know, there he is, Mr. William Torres. All right. You know, it's you see people and they really just don't understand. I tell people, I said, you know, you're sitting on $1 million. They look at me like I'm crazy. Like, oh, like, no, who, me? Not me. They don't believe it. But if they cultivated their network, that would make a big difference.
Yeah, it wasn't me that said this. I forgot where I picked this up or where I heard this. But if you cultivate your network, that you will cultivate your net worth. So, pretty clever. I wish I made that up, but I didn't. I picked it up somewhere.
Yeah. And so you travel all over the country.
I do, and sometimes other countries. I just got back from Bermuda, where I spoke at a big hedge fund conference.
That's awesome.
So that was a lot of fun. And so you get to go to some fun places, without a doubt.
Right, right. Wow, that's pretty cool. And expenses paid in most cases?
The whole deal, sure.
Wow.
Sure.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, yeah, they pay your fee, they pay your expenses, they pay all your stuff. I mean, they're bringing you out there for a very specific purpose, and the purpose is to put more money in their pocket, right? And also to help them with some of the things they're focused on.
Now, how many babies do you have?
Babies as in kids?
Yes.
Children? I've got two little girls. I've got Jessica, who's 12, going on like 20, and Julia, who's 8. Oh, my two, and Jessica was just in a play last night. So I saw her at her school, and she's got this vision of being an actor. She's had some little bit parts in some shows and things like that.
Wow.
So I'm very proud of her about that. And I think the little one wants to kind of follow that path as well. And she's at the point where she's figuring it out right now. Two very different personalities, but all good, all fun. And with all this travel, some of the benefit is that they get to go with me sometimes if school is out, that type of thing. So it was fun bringing them to Bermuda with me. We just stayed the week, you know, so it was cool. So we got a little bit of a break out of it.
So how are their networking skills?
I'd say pretty good. They both have a lot of friends. And, my house seems to be is like Kids Central. I go home and the house is filled with kids because their friends come over. So I'd say they're pretty well networked. They're pretty good at this.
I want you to check something out real quick. Take a listen to this here.
World champion networker Michael Goldberg.
Thank you.
Would you autograph my book?
No, with respect, sir, I'd rather not.
You'd rather not?
I'd, yeah.
We had you here.
It's just something I don't do.
You box, right?
Yeah.
You want some of this?
You want some of this? Wheeler.
I think we got a box.
I think it's on. I think it's on. This is in front of a couple of thousand people.
Okay. Did I just see him roll his neck?
I got to warm up.
Now, these are all military folks. These are military people that are in the insurance business, so they all were fighters.
I'm not going to go easy on
you. This guy knows what he's doing a little bit, huh?
Yeah.
See him switch your hands with the rope.
Yeah. Can't hurt him though. You can't hurt your client. You know, that's a bad thing.
Yeah.
Not a good way to get hired again.
That's right.
I think he sneaks a jab in on me. Let me see. Yeah. I look bad there, huh? Look at that. I wish I could use headgear like that in the ring.
So they are getting ready to. They're putting.
He was stalling. He didn't want to do this. He was stalling. He was backing out.
He's rolling his neck.
Yeah.
Is that? I got to be able to see. No.
No. Thank you. He's getting nervous.
See, I didn't get a hug.
Wait a minute.
He gets a hug. I didn't get a hug.
First, we got to check punching power, right? Let's see what you got, big boy.
That was a real punching meter?
No.
Okay.
See, they know I love Tyson.
That's not my bag, baby. Wait a minute. Somebody back. That was Rocky Marciano yesterday. Okay. I think the gloves are off. It's me and you, buddy.
Now, where was this at?
I think it was Phoenix.
Oh, they got the whole fight thing.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the main event.
This is a big life insurance company in the military.
Let's get ready to rumble!
No mas! No mas! Michael Goldberg! Thank you, buddy.
Knockout Networking. Oh, that was in July, too.
Sleeve, that was a while ago. Sleeves always rolled up.
Ready to go.
Always.
So what would be the ultimate place you'd like to speak? Like, you haven't spoken for yet. Like, this would be the ultimate.
I would love to speak in Hawaii. I've never been there before. I've had some opportunities. It's just never happened, but I'd love to do that. Mm-hmm. And then I'd love to, and I've got some of these things actually going on right now, so we'll see if it happens, but I'd love to speak in the UK. I'd love to speak in Australia. So I think I'd like to do a lot more international stuff. I just spoke last year at a conference called the Million Dollar Roundtable, which is a big deal in the life insurance industry and kind of an honor to be brought in to do that.
Okay.
So there's a big international focus with that, although I did that. That happened to be in Canada. But because of that, I made a lot of, you know, my own inroads where I might end up doing some stuff in the UK and in Australia. So I'm trying to work all those different things out. So hopefully that happens next year.
So what was that experience like?
Well, you know, you're with top producers, so it's top producers in the life insurance industry. Mm-hmm. You know, so you're sharing your ideas with people that are already pretty good at what they do. It's an honor for them to be there. And there's like 14,000 people there, so it's a big-time convention.
Wow.
You know, without a doubt. I wasn't in front of all 14,000, but it's a big convention. So there's a lot going on. It's an honor to qualify if you're a life insurance producer, but it's also an honor to be asked if your customers are in that field. So just to be part of that is kind of a big deal. A lot of energy. I met a lot of other speakers as well. And some of the connections that I made there, you know, I'm still going back and forth with these people. So all good.
Wow. That's pretty cool. That is the $1 million roundtable. I've heard about that.
Yeah, that's a big deal.
Yeah.
That's a big deal.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, in my business, it's, getting back to the whole connection thing, it's, you know, when you're doing a presentation, when you're doing a speech, when you're doing a training, when you're doing any type of talk, you know, you want to be able to morph that into other opportunities where you might speak. And if you have people that are in your audience that run firms, you know, or have a team themselves and they like some of your ideas, you know, it just keeps going. You know, there's always opportunities to travel to different places. You know, to do different talks, to meet more people. It's just a vicious cycle. You know, if you do it right, you're good.
Yeah. Can you believe that we're pretty much at the end right now?
That went by like a 3-minute round.
Yeah. Wow. That is amazing. Went by really fast.
Yeah, it did.
So what final message that you would want to leave, deliver, that you would want to share? You know what? Let me ask you I haven't asked this question in a long time. If I gave you $100.
$100.
I put you in a city where you didn't know anybody. You couldn't know anybody and you couldn't do a lifeline. You had to work from that $100 in a new city. You didn't know anybody. How would Michael Goldberg survive with that $100 in a new city? What would he do?
What would I do? What's my goal? What's my purpose?
Well, your goal is you want to get up on your feet.
Yeah.
You know, as soon as possible. You want to, you got is $100. So you got to find a place to live, eat. What are you going to do?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think I would look in places where I would meet probably the most business people. I think that's where I would start. Maybe a chamber of commerce. That's probably what I would do. New York City, I would go to the Chamber of Commerce. That would be a good place to start, since it's all about making connections, and I would introduce myself. And that wouldn't cost me very much at all. And, you know, I would tell them some of the things that I was after. I'm looking to start a business. I'm looking to become a boxer. I'm looking to whatever it is. And I would just ask them, you know, direct me. Tell me where I need to go. What do I need to say? With whom do I need to say it? But I would have to know exactly what it is that I was after specifically. You know, where I wanted to live, how I wanted to live, who I wanted to meet, how I wanted to spend my time. But I would just go to the epicenter of any city. It'd probably be a chamber of commerce or maybe a professional association at some point. There's a lot of boxing associations. That wouldn't be a bad place to start either. So a place where it's organized, where like-minded people get together that are getting together to do something that they love and ultimately that I love. That's where I would go.
Wow. But then all you got is $100, so you can't, like, you got to find a place to live and eat too.
Yeah, well, I'd ask them. I'd say, look, I only have $100 to spend. You know, so direct me. Where do I need to go? What do I need to say? With whom do I need to say it in order to live where I want to live? I've got $100, and also I need to now turn this into $200, $500. How would you suggest I do that?
There you go. Michael Goldberg, ladies and gentlemen, awesome. Knockout Networking. Give me your website, Michael.
Website is www.knockoutnetworking.com. Knockoutnetworking.com.
All right, good. Thank you, man. Michael, thank you. You've been great.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate it. And my friend, keep the left up.
All right. Okay.
I'll live. thank you now for all my pain. What would you have done if you had been me? I lived and breathed what I believe. Now I found my place in history.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Yeah. días. Hola, 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 hola. Qué bien, qué nice. Otro viernes más. Lleno de contentura, traigo un cerón. Vengo activado. Dándole las gracias a ese gran creador. Qué lástima que muchos nos pongamos, me voy a incluir, nos pongamos a pensar que cómo se hizo el mundo, ¿eh? Para poder creerle a ese señor de arriba, Jehová Dios. Póngase a pensar usted la máquina que es. Articular palabras. Por ejemplo, y esa señal llegar allá donde ustedes están lejos. ¿Quién inventó eso? ¿Quién le dio el poder al hombre para aprender tantas cosas? ¿Cómo un avión puede volar con tanta gente arriba? Póngase... ¡Ay, Dios! Simplemente te quiero dar las gracias, Señor. Al Padre Jehová, al Creador y a su Hijo, mi Salvador. Qué lindo es el Salvador. Y no es porque sea mi segundo nombre. Ay, qué lindo. No, no, yo me sonrío. De lo lindo, de las cosas lindas que tiene ese señor para nosotros. No me canso de darle las gracias. De decirle, yo estoy aquí a tu servicio, Señor. Me has dado demasiado, demasiado, demasiado. Lo que no... Prácticamente lo que no merece tú me lo... No, lo que no merezco tú me lo das. De verdad, de verdad. Vamos a hacer formar una vida mejor. Vamos a forjar una vida mejor. Desde hoy en adelante. Vamos a ser más positivos. Vamos a ser más alegres. Sin hacerle daño a nadie. Sin tomarle la alegría prestada a nadie. Absolutamente nadie. Dios te dio un talento. Explótalo. Descubre ese talento. Utilízalo. No copie de los demás. Si es las cosas buenas, sí. Copia lo bueno, pero no lo malo. Coge, 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 coge energía positiva. Ponte las pilas. Que yo me la puse. Como siempre, honor a Don Merengue. Una hora típica, sin interrupción, solo en una estación 90.3 FM. ¡Pero qué viernes más fantástico!
Y si viene un aguacero, seguro sale corriendo. Corre, corre, que viene agua.
Corre, corre, que va a llover.
Corre, corre, que no mojado.
Corre, corre, que va a llover.
Tráigale un paraguas.
Corre, corre, que va a llover.
Amable Guzmán.
Corre, corre, que va a llover.
Corre, que te moja.
Corre, corre, que va a llover.
Corre, corre.